Hey, time out. Actually, I don't have anything from time out for you this week, but what I do have is this real Facebook post that I found over at Your Third Favorite Podcast, which is a fantastic YouTube show. You should go check those guys out. And did you know that the Bible was actually written by the greatest American who ever lived, died, and then lived again? Jesus? Actually, no, I hope you know that Jesus wasn't American. But can you think of a better question that we should be tackling in Holy Week? I can't either. Let's unpack this right now on Overtime. Hey everyone, my name is Josh. Welcome to Overtime, a series of videos where we look at some of the most popular and controversial topics in Christianity, and we do a deep dive to unpack the discussion and have some dialogue. So in recognition of Holy Week, we're gonna look into one of the last acts Jesus did upon the cross. The focus here is gonna be on John 19, 28 through 30, which reads like this. The soldiers put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now, I believe that everyone understands that the Bible was not originally written in your native tongue. To date, the Bible has been translated into hundreds of languages in an ongoing effort to reach every people group on earth with the gospel written in each person's native language. Now, most of the Old Testament was written in ancient Hebrew, most of the New Testament in Koine Greek, and the language spoken by Jesus and his pals would have been Aramaic. And scholars have taken great care to interpret scripture as accurately and faithfully as humanly possible. And as a result, most translations are remarkably dependable in communicating the timeless truths that are taught in scripture. Even though the core tenets and historic accounts translated into the major accredited biblical translations like the English NIV, NRSV, NKJV, etc., can be trusted wholly, there are rich layers in truth and nuances to be discovered when we look at scripture through the lens of the original language in which it was recorded. So today, I'd like to share one powerful example of this and focus on Jesus' last words. Jesus uttered the phrase, "It is finished." The word used in the original Gospel of John is the Greek word tetelestai, which in its time had numerous applications that I want to share with you and that I hope helps you see with greater clarity what Jesus was proclaiming in his last breath. So first, the word tetelestai is unique to a native English speaker because the tense that it is used in is a little bit different than what we usually use in English. You see, in English, we have the past tense to denote something that happened at a specific time and the present tense for something that's usually happening in the moment. The Greek language has a tense known as the pluperfect tense, which is not terribly common in English. And as a result, there's a limitation on our own language because some of the meaning of the proclamation tetelestai, which means it is finished, kind of gets lost in translation a little bit. The pluperfect tense is a combination of two specific Greek tenses. You have the present tense and then the aorist tense. The aorist tense is what's known as punctiliar, meaning that something happened at a specific point in time, right? Like a moment. And the pluperfect tense, though, is linear, meaning that something that continues on into the future and has ongoing results or implications, like in perpetuity or without end. Now, the pluperfect tense is used very infrequently in the Gospels, so when it is used, the point or event being highlighted is of the utmost significance. And when the pluperfect tense is invoked, there's usually a definite and deliberate reason why it was chosen by the writer. The emphasis may be on the culmination of the action's progress or on the resulting state of affairs brought about by the specific action. So, to actually provide some context and helpful meaning here of the word tetelestai, it's going to be useful to note some of the applications of the word used in biblical times. So first, this would be used sometimes when how a servant would respond to his master. The servant would use the term tetelestai when reporting to their master, basically saying, "I have completed," right, tetelestai, "the work that's been assigned to me." Sometimes it would appear in business and commerce, right, when the process of transferring a property deed came up, for example. So the transfer of ownership was not in effect until the deed was dated and signed. And when this was realized, the clerk would write tetelestai across the deed, indicating that the transaction was indeed complete. There was no more contingencies, the transfer of property had officially happened, and there was a new owner. When someone had a debt and it was paid off, the creditor would write tetelestai across the certificate of debt, signifying that it was paid in full, but there was nothing more required of the debtor. Now in religion, a Hebrew priest would examine animals for blemishes before they were to be sacrificed. If the lamb was faultless or perfect and acceptable for sacrifice, the priest might say tetelestai. Now in the law, when a Roman citizen was convicted of a crime and thrown into prison, a certificate of debt listing all of his crimes would be nailed to his cell door so that anyone passing by could know what laws a prisoner had broken and the penalty assigned to that incarcerated person. When the prisoner had served their sentence and was released from bondage, the indictment was taken down from the door and a judge who had put him in prison would sign the indictment and write across it the word tetelestai. The freed prisoner was then given this document and if questioned as to to why he was out of jail, he could actually point to the indictment across which the judge had written the word Tetelestai. This term would guarantee this person's deliverance and their liberty, and the charges for those crimes could never again be brought against him. Or in art, when the painter or the sculptor had put the last finishing touches on their painting or marble bust, they would stand back a few feet to admire their masterpiece. And once determined that there was nothing that called for correction or improvement, the artist would exclaim, "Tetelestai, it's finished, right? Nothing more can or should be added to the project. It is complete as is." As Frank Borum states, all the Old Testament pictures of the Messiah were fulfilled in Christ and were only a shadow of what is to come. But the substance or the reality actually belongs to Christ, like we see in Colossians 2:17. Now, the death of Jesus on the cross finished the picture of redemption, a masterpiece which had been on the Father's heart from before the foundation of the world. These applications have helped me better understand what Jesus has done for me by his act upon the cross. You see, it was an act of submission to our Heavenly Father. "Not my will, but your will be done," he says. It was a work of art, perfect in its completion. It was payment in full, never needing to worry about another bill that was coming due. It was satisfying in full the penalty for breaking the law. Finally, right, Tetelestai was proclaimed in the pluperfect tense, demarking a specific moment in time that would be in effect for forever. A powerful and permanent rebuke to our accuser Satan that allows us to boldly proclaim that there is no more condemnation. There's no more price for us to pay, time to serve, or sacrifice to give, because it has been done. It is being done, and it will continue to be done without ceasing by the sacrificial act of Jesus on the cross. You see, what's left for us to do is to accept Jesus' action on our behalf without condemnation and acknowledge that there is nothing that we can do and no penance that we can pay to satisfy the debt that we owe, because we don't actually have to worry about that anymore because it has been paid in full by Jesus on our behalf. Tetelestai. What are your thoughts? Did this exploration of the Greek word telestai help you gain a fuller understanding about what it means to be forgiven by God? Did we miss anything? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Let us know, and until next time, we'll see you in the comments.